Once again today, in the name of Jesus, our wonderful Lord and Savior, we come to you out in the radio listening audience and you here in the auditorium. We appreciate you tuning in out there in the radio listening audience. This is Preacher Edward speaking. Appreciate you being here in the auditorium of the Northside Baptist Church. We're looking forward to a good hour. And I hope someone in the radio listening audience to get on the phone and call a friend, have them to tune in and get this hour coming up. Now the message today and the music will be on tape number 348. I appreciate John's playing in Viola's place today. There'd be a lot of people who give all they could bum, bear, beg, and borrow in the way of money, plus more if they had the talent John has to play the instrument, organ, and piano. Anybody that has a talent like that, you know, a lot of people have talent like that. They'd just give anything for it. And many times we that have ability to preach or teach or play or sing, we just kindly take it for granted. Well, we just do that and that's it. I remember back whenever we started giving John music, if I had the time to go over, I'd beg, borrow, and do everything I could to get money to give my wife piano lessons. We could have done it back then, but I didn't have the money to do so. Money was hard to get in those days, and we have regretted that. Regretted not giving her music lessons. She's only about 25 years old at that time, and she could have very well learned and been just as good as any other we have here in the church today, and we sorry about it. That's what over the dam. But if you can take music and give your child music, it'd be well worthwhile. If you do so, you'd be glad you did when you come to the end of life's journey. Anything you do for God, you don't have long here. And I don't have long here on the earth. And anything you do for God, you ought to do it and do it willingly because you love God and not because you think you have to or to please some individual, but do it for God and the glory of God. Because you're going to be glad you did when you come to die. The only thing that's going to count when you come to die is what you've done for God. I don't care what you accumulate, how popular you may be, or how good you may be, how kind you may be. When you come down to face death, the only thing that's going to count in that hour, what have I done for God? Do I know Jesus Christ is my Savior? What have I done for God on the earth? Going to be many, many tears shed over regrets of what we could have done for God. That includes this preacher, every other minister and teacher, musician, and singer or whatnot, or a Christian. What have we done for God? So you can get this tape by writing in and enclose a gift of $3 or more to help defray our radio expense. And just write in and say, Preacher Edward, send me tape number 348. I'm going to speak on the seven sins unto death. Seven sins unto death. Now, this is a solemn message. And we bring this message with fear and trembling. And I want you to hear it. And I want you to hear me well. As I bring this message, no time to be thumbing through songbooks. No time to be talking, laughing, carrying on. I want you to hear this message. No time to be reading some magazine or something like that. And I don't care whether you hear out in the radio listening audience, you need to get this message. Seven sins unto death. Because this sermon can be applied to all of our hearts. It can be applied to this preacher, to you, and everyone that's listening has been born of the Spirit of God. And I want you to hear it. If you'd like to have it on tape, I want you to write in and get it. My mailing address is Virgil Edwards, P.O. Box 501, Athens, Georgia. 30603 is the zip code number. I'd like to hear from you. Write to me next week. I appreciate it so very much. We'd like to hear from our radio listening audience. We covet your prayers. I want you to pray for us as we sojourn. Now, I'm reading, first of all, from John chapter 15. I want you to turn there. John chapter 15 in the original Scofield Reference Bible. Page 1136, and beginning with verse 1. I am the true vine, and my Father is the husbandman. Every branch in me that beareth not fruit, he taketh away. And every branch that beareth fruit, he purges it, that it may bring forth more fruit. You are clean through the word which I have spoken unto you. Now look at verse 2. Every branch in me that beareth not fruit, he taketh away. And every branch that beareth fruit, he purges it, that it may bring forth more fruit. That's going to fit well into my message. I want you to turn, would you please, to 1 John chapter 5. 1 John chapter 5. I want to read verse 16. Page 1325. If any man see his brother sin a sin, which is not unto death, he shall ask and shall give him, and shall give him life. For them that sin not unto death, there is a sin unto death. I do not say that he shall pray for it. Now he's talking here to God's people, not the sinner. We're not talking here about the unpardonable sin. We're talking about sin in the life of Christian people. There is a sin unto death. There's a lot of people that are saved on the earth and been saved on the earth that's now in heaven, could be down here serving God, laying up rewards, doing things for God, had they walked straight, had they done right. But because of the sin in their life, God took them out early. They died a premature death. Multitudes today in heaven that died before their time because they failed to abide according to the word of God. And that's what I want you to hear today. Many Christians die because of things they do upon the earth before God's allotted time for them to die. They miss out on the rewards, and they face God with a red face in the day whenever God judges people. The Bible said we ought not to be ashamed at his appearing. The first sin I want to mention, the sin unto death, is the sin of lying to the Holy Ghost, the Holy Spirit. It's a serious thing for a Christian to lie to the Spirit of God. In Acts chapter 5, verses 3 through 5, but Peter said, Ananias, why has Satan filled thine heart to lie to the Holy Ghost, to keep back part of the price of the land after it was sold? Was it not in thine own power? For why hast thou conceived this in thine heart? Thou hast not lied unto men, but unto God. And Ananias, hearing these words, fell down and gave up the ghost, and great fear came on all them that heard these things. In verse 10 of the same chapter, speaking of his wife, then she fell down straightway at his feet and gave up the ghost. Now here we find a couple of people in the early church back lying to the Spirit of God. Barnabas had sold some land and gave everything he got from that land into God's work. And then they praised Barnabas. He didn't seek praise from man. He did it because he loved God. And then, of course, they exalted him. Men did. They praised him for it. But he wasn't seeking for that. Ananias and Sapphira thought they would like to get it on the praise and the glory. So they had land and sold it. And then they connived together how that they'd keep back part of the price, go down to the church, pretend they're giving all the money they received from the land, and then they would be receive glory and praise like Barnabas and others. So they sold the land, hid part of the money, went down to the church. He went first. And he came down and said, we sold our land. We give it all to the church. Simon Peter looked at him with those Holy Ghost-filled eyes and said, you're lying to the Holy Ghost. It was your land before you sold it. It's your money after you sold the land. And now you've kept part of the money. You came down and lied to the Holy Ghost and claim you're giving all the money to the God's work, and you're lying in the house of God. And when he told him that, he dropped dead. Simon Peter said, you ushers, pick him up and carry him out. He continued on preaching. About 3 hours later, his wife came in. She thought, by this time, they'd be through praising my husband, and I'll have all the attention. She came in, came walking down, and she told the same lie her husband did, claimed that they gave all the money received from the land. And Simon Peter said, you have lied to the Holy Ghost also. And she dropped dead in the church. He said, get her out of here. And he continued preaching on that day. But these people lied to the Holy Ghost, and God killed them in the church. It's a dangerous thing to lie to the Spirit of God, to the Holy Ghost of God, claiming things that you don't do and taking and receiving glory from it. And you know you didn't do it, and you don't deserve the glory. That's exactly what they did. Sin number two is the sin of living after the flesh. Now the Bible says in Romans chapter 8 verse 13, if you live after the flesh, ye shall die. But if you through the Spirit do mortify the deeds of the body, ye shall live. Now to live after the flesh is to continue on to satisfy the body which is with the things of the world, and continue on and on in that manner. And the Bible said, if you live after the flesh, you shall die. There's Christian people or saved people on the earth today, right now in heaven, that never would give up the world, never would give up the flesh, and continue to live after the flesh, and they died before their time. The Bible is clear on that. Now the Word of God tells us when you get saved, you don't belong to yourself any longer. You belong to God. Your body belongs to God. And if you continue on and on and on, and God is long-suffering and merciful, and the mills of God grind slowly, but they grind, and you continue on and on and on, and God extends His mercy and pleading with you, God will put you in a hole in the ground. You'll die, the Bible tells us, and die before your time. Christian people can't go out here and live like the devil, live like the world, and then at the same time expect to live a good life and go to heaven when they die. You can't do that. God says no. The Bible says if we live after the flesh, we'll die before our time. Oh, you may say, now preach, Edwards, I know I haven't lived as holy as I should, and I've lived somewhat after the flesh. What must I do about it? Get on your knees, ask God to forgive you. By the grace of God, live for God before God has to cut you off and carry you to heaven before your time. God does that. He did that in the Bible, as we see as we move on through the Word of God. The sin of living after the flesh is the second sin unto death. That is a sin unto death. I'm giving you chapter and verse what I say today, and you need to follow me in the Word of God. Number three, another sin unto death is defiling the temple of God, which is your body. Your body is a temple of the Holy Ghost. He lives in your body. The Spirit of God lives in you, and your body is a temple. It doesn't belong to you anymore. It belongs to God. And 1 Corinthians chapter 3 and verse 17, if any man defile the temple of God, him shall God destroy. For the temple of God is holy, which temple ye are. Now the Bible says you continue to defile that temple, and you're headed for a hole in the ground. You'll die before your time, a sin unto death, because you defile the temple of God. Now you may say, preach, Edwards, how may I defile the temple of God? I want to know. I want to be careful about it. Well, I'll tell you how you can do it. Number one, you can defile the temple by an unholy attitude. If you're a child of God and you go on with an unholy attitude day after day and day after day, that's a dangerous thing. You could end up later, with other things I'm going to mention here, dying a premature death. An unholy attitude. Every born-again believer ought to have a good Christian attitude, a kind attitude, a loving attitude, a patient attitude. We ought to have the right attitude. God expects us to do so as His children. Secondly, you can defile that temple by hatred. It's a dangerous thing for a child of God to go around with hatred in his heart towards somebody. No doubt maybe somebody's mistreated you and done you wrong. I've been mistreated and done wrong by many people since I've been saved, and you have too. And we can't keep that hatred in our hearts on indefinitely. God is patient, long-suffering, but you got to get that hatred out. If you don't get that hatred out of your heart along with a bad attitude, you're moving toward a premature death. As certain as I'm speaking to you today, you're moving toward the sin unto death. A hatred in your heart. You may say, preacher, I have hatred in my heart. Somebody, you just don't know what somebody did to me. Well, what you need to do is get on your knees, ask God to move that hatred, take it out of your heart, and give you grace. I know a couple in Greenville, South Carolina, despised and hated one another. And the preacher cut them down in the basement. They got right with God and right with each other. That morning when they left the church, they walked down the street arm in arm, having blessed fellowship, because that hatred had been moved out. You can't hold that in your heart. If you do, you're liable to go before your time. Not only that, malice. If you have malice in your heart, it's a dangerous thing. Don't go around with malice in your heart toward others. It's wrong, it's bad, it's sinful. And then evil thinking helps defile the temple. Evil thinking. Now you may say, Preach Edwards, I can't help but think evil sometimes. Well, we're in the Adamic body. As long as you're in the Adamic body, you're going to think evil occasionally. Now let me use this illustration. You can't keep a bird from flying over your head. But you most certainly can keep that bird from building a nest, laying an egg, and hatching a young out on your head. That bird will fly over your head, but don't let it light on your head and remain there. Because you can't help having evil thoughts because you're in that Adamic body. And you're going to have evil thoughts. Now I'm going to have them. But we can't dwell on them and dwell on them and dwell on them and let them become sin in our life. We got to ask God to help us and give us victory. And God will. But if you let that bird stay on your head long enough, that bird's going to build a nest there and hatch out a young. It's going to be great damage to you because your body is a temple of the Holy Ghost. When the bird flies over, just say, God, help me. No, let that bird light on my head. Help me, dear Lord. And God's able to do that. Evil thinking. We all have evil thoughts many times, and that you're going to have them. I don't care how holy you are. You're going to have evil thoughts that come in your way, but you don't have to just continue to dwell on them and dwell on them and dwell on them until they become sin in your life that you can't handle them. And then an unforgiving spirit. An unforgiving spirit is, of course, it's a sin against the temple. An unforgiving spirit. Now, if somebody mistreats you, and I've been mistreated, and you have too, by many people, we can't go on forever and hold an unforgiving spirit in our hearts. If we do, we're defiling the temple of the Holy Ghost. Now, God can give us victory over that very thing. Now, if somebody fails to forgive an individual, and you hold an unforgiving spirit in your heart as a Christian, and a lot of saved people say, well, I'll forgive that person, but I'll have you to understand I won't forget it. Well, you haven't forgiven them if you have that attitude. Now, if you have that attitude that you won't forget it, it's still down in your heart, that you're going to hold it there, then you're adding to these sins, defiling the temple, and you're on dangerous ground. Help God get that unforgiving spirit out of your heart, be willing to forgive people, and especially if they ask you to forgive them. If they don't ask you, then that's a different story. But if they ask you to forgive them, you be sure that you're willing to forgive them and don't hold that in your heart. It's a dangerous thing. It adds to the destruction of the temple, defilement of the temple, rather. And then bitterness is something else that helps defile your body. You can't go around with bitterness in your heart against individuals. I've seen people in churches become so embittered, they had bitterness in their heart against others, and seemed like they just couldn't get over it, and it affected their spiritual welfare. It affects them in many ways. That old bitterness is there against that individual. That person did something wrong against them probably, and you're holding that bitterness in your heart. You can't do that. That's wrong. That's defiling that temple. You got to get that bitterness out of your heart. Jesus didn't hold bitterness in his heart against those that mistreated him. You need to realize if you hold that in your heart, it's defiling your body. It's defiling that temple, and it's dead wrong. Get it out. God will take it out if you'll ask him. God will help you. And then by unholy association, in that way you can defile the temple. In 1 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 9 through 11, I wrote unto you an epistle not to company with fornicators, or with covetous, or extortioners, or idolaters. Unholy association. You need to realize when God saves you, you're not to hobnob around with every tall baby in the world out here living for the devil. You're to run with God's people, associate with God's people, associate with the right crowd. Now, you can't get into pour a clean water into a muddy stream and expect it to be clean. You can't do that. The same fountain don't produce sweet water and bitter water. Now, God expects you to watch the people you associate with, your friends, your neighbors, your relatives, and don't associate with people That's going to cause you to defile the temple of the Holy Ghost, running with fornicators and covetous people, extortionists and idolaters. God said, don't do it. You're defiling the temple of the Holy Ghost. And that may bring an early death for you. Then unholy assimilation. Now you listen to this. Let me have your ears just a minute. You listen to this. Unholy assimilation. What do you mean, preacher? Well, there's a lot of God's people, precious people, that take things into their body that's destroying that body. That body belongs to God. You need to be careful what you take into your body if you know it's destroying your body. I feel for you to have habits of different kind, and you're having to battle over giving them up and getting rid of it. I feel for you. You have my sympathy. I've been along there. But you are defiling that body and assimilating into that body poison that's absolutely helping destroy that temple. And there you're defiling the temple of God. You ought to do something about it. You can. You can be bigger than any habit you may have. I don't care what it is. You can be bigger than that habit if you really get down to business and mean business and be willing to take it on the chin and move on for God. You live longer. But you go on defiling that temple, and you may go to a premature grave before you realize it. There's a lot of people in the grave today because they're assimilating in their bodies alcohol, dope, tobacco, or whatnot that destroyed that body. And they went on before their time. A sin unto death. Number four, there's a sin of fornication. In 1 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 1 through 5. Now I won't take time to read it. I'll tell you what it means. But I'm going to read verses 16 through 18. What know you not that he which is joined to a harlot is one body, for two saith he shall be one flesh, but he that is joined unto the Lord is one spirit. Flee fornication. In 1 Corinthians chapter 5, you have here a man who no doubt his mother had died and his father married again, and then he took his father's wife and began to live with her, and he was a saved man and there in the church at Corinth and began to live with his father's wife. And there you have this fornication. And the apostle Paul wrote and said, turn that man over to Satan for the destruction of the flesh. If he don't get right, turn him over to the devil for the destruction of the flesh. But the man got right. He got right with God, as you find in 2 Corinthians. But Paul said he had to flee this kind of stuff because you're headed toward a premature grave. And this man was committing this kind of sin there in the church at Corinth. And had he not gotten right with God and given it up, then the devil would destroy him. God would allow that to happen. When they turned him over to Satan, Satan would destroy his flesh and he'd have gone to a premature grave. The sin of fornication. Number five is a sin of murmuring. It is a sin unto death. The sin of murmuring, a sin unto death. In Numbers chapter 14, verses 36 and 37, and the men which Moses sent to search the land who returned and made all the congregation to murmur against him by bringing up a slander upon the land, even these men that did bring up the evil report upon the land died by the plague before the Lord. Here we find that Moses sent 12 men into the Canaan land to spy out the land. They went over there to reconnoiter the land where they were going. And they came back, and 10 of them brought an evil report. They slandered the land. Only two brought a good report. And the Bible said these men that brought that evil report upon the land died by the plague before the Lord. God never let them go in. They died a premature death. And because they murmured and complained about Moses leading the people in the land of Canaan, they said, we can't go in. We can't take the land. There's giants over there. We look like grasshoppers in their sight. We just can't do it. And God said, all right, I'll let you die with your boots on. You don't believe me anyway. And they died a premature death because they murmured and complained and got the people murmuring and complaining. 10 of them came back, stirred those Israelites up, and they began to murmur against God, murmur against Moses. And God let them die with their boots on, all that generation, raised up a young generation, and Joshua carried them across. This murmuring was against God. It was against God. It's a dangerous thing to murmur against God. We're not to murmur against the things of God and what we have. The Bible says in Philippians chapter 4 and verse 11, says, not that I speak in respect of want, for I learn whatsoever things I have, I therewith therefore be content. Paul says here in Philippians chapter 4 and verse 11, what I have, I'm to be content. He said, I'm not to murmur and complain about something I don't have, and then someone else comes along, they have more than I have. I'm not to murmur and complain about that, Paul said. Paul said, I'm to be content with such things as I have. Not murmur and complain against what you have. I'll tell you, we people here in America, we're fortunate. We're rich people living in a rich land, and God's people should never murmur and complain about what you have. If you had to live yonder in Africa or India or someplace where they're starving to death, then you see what I mean. In Hebrews chapter 13 and verse 5, let your conversation be without covetousness, and be content with such things as you have. For he said, I'll never leave thee nor forsake thee. So don't grumble about it. Don't grumble about what you have. You could be in far worse shape than what you are now. And there's millions of people in far worse shape than you are. And worse shape than I am. As God's people, it's a sin for us to murmur. And if we continue to murmur and complain, it's a sin unto death. Now God let these people die because they kept murmuring and complaining. And that's something a child of God should not do. You ought to praise God for the air you breathe, the water you drink, the clothes you wear, the shelter in which you live, the job you have, and what health you do have. And you ought to thank God for it every day and not murmur and complain and gripe and grumble about what you have. It's a sin. God may let you die a premature death. Murmuring and complaining about what you have is a sin, and a sin of murmuring, and it's one of the sins unto death. The Bible said there is a sin unto death. We need to realize that. We move on to number 6, and that is the sin of misbehaving at the Lord's table. Now in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 29 and 30, for he that eateth and drinketh unworthily, eateth and drinketh damnation to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. Now listen to this, verse 30. For this cause many are weak and sickly among you, and many sleep. That means many die. Now those people there at Corinth, because they would come in and whenever they're supposed to be having the Lord's Supper, they would have a supper of their kind and drink their wine, eat their bread. A lot of hungry people around there with nothing to eat and on starvation. And they would come and put on a big show, and they wouldn't get right with God. They wouldn't discontinue that. And the Bible said many of them became sickly, and many of them died because of taking the Lord's Supper unworthily. That is, they were eating and drinking wine and getting drunk. And whenever they'd come to have the Lord's Supper, within their own meal they were having, and other people starving and poor, hungry people there with nothing to eat, and come there whenever they're supposed to be the church taking the Lord's Supper, they had their crowd out there eating and drinking and getting drunk, and God just put them in a hole in the ground. They were saved people, yes. And the Bible said many of them were weak, and many of them sickly. Now, I'm going to say something right here, and I want you to hold to your seat. You might put on your seat belt if you please, if you have one. Listen to me. Don't misunderstand what I'm going to say. Now, all sickness and weakness in the body is not because of sin necessarily that you committed, but much of it is. Much of the sickness and much of the weakness in the body is because of sins you committed. And sins you're still committing. And God said you go into an early grave because of it. And many Christian people to have a healthy body, be stronger, if they'd walk with God and get rid of their sins and live for God. Now getting back to what I said, not all sickness, not all weak bodies is because of sin you're actually committing. I'm not saying that. But I have said some of it is. And you need to realize that. If you had served God and get right with God and get on the altar for God and use your talent for God and do what you can for God, God might give you a better body to live in. A lot of people have a weak body, a suffering body, and maybe getting worse all the time because they're not willing to do what they know they ought to do for God. They're not willing to tithe their income and not willing to serve God and use their talent. They're not willing to be faithful in serving God. They don't care anything about God's house, just come for respectability occasionally. And they're going to get worse in their body physically. You have no right to claim God's going to help you and strengthen your body if you're going to live for yourself all the time and ignore God. God will ignore you. Just let you go on and have the bellyache, backache, headache, eyeache, footache, or whatever. If you're going to ignore God and not willing to be used of God, not use your talent for God, not willing to give God his part of your income, not willing to be faithful in serving God, what right do you have to say, God, have mercy on me? You've ignored him, he's going to ignore you, let you go on and die premature death. Let you die before your time. That is a sin unto death. If you want God's best for you, and God's good, genuine goodness and healing and so forth for you, you walk with God, be faithful to God, serve God, support God's work, do what God you should do for God, and see what happens to you. You're going to find out you're going to be living in a different world and probably a different body in respect to serving God. You just go ahead, be hard-headed, stubborn, say, well, preacher, I'm not going to pay attention to what you said. All right, just go ahead. Go right on and make your bed hard, you're going to lie in it. And so remember, behaving in this manner can bring sickness, it can bring a premature death. Getting back, lest you forget what I said, don't falsely accuse this Baptist preacher, you'll answer to God for it if you do. I'm not saying that your sickness and your illness is all because of sin that you're committing now. Some of it may be, some of it may not be, all of it may be, none of it may be. It's a matter between you and God. And you to find that out between you and God. Because these old bodies are going to get in worse shape, they're going to wear out, and eventually something's going to happen to these bodies, and we're going to have pain and sickness in our bodies. In spite of all we can do, I don't care how devoted to God you are. But a lot of people have less pain, less doctor bills, less suffering, if they'd really do what they ought to do for God. I base that on the Word of God. I believe that with all of my heart. And that's true. But go on and die premature death if you want to. I can stand here and name multitudes that died a premature death for that same reason. And they came together for the worse. Then sin number 7 is a sin of rebellion of chastisement. In Hebrews chapter 12 and verse 9, furthermore, we have fathers of our flesh which correct us, and we give them reverence. Shall we not much more be in subjection unto the Father of spirits and live? Now, what is God saying? God is saying he whips his children. God is saying he chastises his children. God says he corrects his children. Now, if you rebel against that chastisement, and you know what God is chastising you for, and you're going to rebel against it, you're going to die. The Bible says it's a sin unto death to rebel against that chastisement. When you know God is chasing you for something wrong, and you're going to rebel against God, against that chastisement, get ready to get your cemetery lot, because that's exactly where you're going if you continue in that direction. Let me give you that verse again. Furthermore, we have fathers of our flesh which correct us, and we give them reverence. Shall we not much more be in subject unto the Father's spirits, that's God, and live, and live, and live. Be in subjection to God's chastisement. And when God chastens you for something, then stop doing it. Ask God to forgive you. And verse 10, for they verily for a few days chasten us after their pleasure, but he for our profit, that we might be partakers of his holiness. So God wants you to be holy. And that's why God chastises you, is to make you become holy on the earth and live for him. God don't chasten the devil's crowd. God will handle that gang of wicked people that have no fear of God and no concern about the gospel, no concern about the things of God. Hellfire will take care of them. But God takes care of his children, and God will chasten you, and God may let you go ahead if your heart is disturbing and commit the sin unto death. Many years ago, yonder in the city of Greenville, South Carolina, there's a family over there, and they were part-ending, and they loved God. And the whole family got right with God, and the husband, his name was Lockheed. Mr. Lockheed backslid on God. He had one of the greatest, most consecrated women I've ever associated with in God's house. She prayed for him daily, the church prayed for him daily. And she wanted to get back into fellowship with God. And they prayed on and on and on and talked. And the preacher talked with him. The deacons talked with him. And tried to get him to come back to God. But he rebelled. He got to loving the world out there too much. He wouldn't give the world up. Get back with God. One day he called his wife in. He took sick. He called his wife in. He said, "Honey, I hate to break the news to you. But I'm going to die." She said, "What do you mean you're going to die?" He said, "Well, it's just been revealed to me. I'm going to die." He said, "I failed to come back to God through chastisement, and God's going to take me out of the world." And he died. Many years ago, I knew a man in a certain county in Georgia. I'll not call the name of the county. This man and his wife were holy, gracious people. They had prayer meetings in the home about every Thursday night. In those days, you didn't have many places to go to church. They had prayer meetings in the home. They loved God with all their heart. That woman could lay hold on God and pray down the power of God like very few women could. And they had great testimony. This man got into politics. He ran for a position. He won out. He got into politics. And then the first thing they knew, he would be late getting in for the Thursday night prayer meeting. Then time came whenever he'd miss one occasionally. And then he would miss two. And then he kept missing more of the prayer meetings. His wife was greatly burdened and people concerned about him and kept missing. Well, finally, just quit coming at all. And they pleaded with him and begged with him. But he got out into the world, got into politics. He got involved with other things that I won't mention and completely just left God out of his life. Now, listen to me. He and his wife was coming from a certain town. I won't mention the town one Friday afternoon. And is coming from a funeral. And he turned to his wife and he said, "Honey, I'm going to tell you something. It may shock you." She said, "What is it?" He said, "Sunday night, I'll be in the grave." She said, "What do you mean?" He said, "Well, it's been revealed to me because of my disobedience, contrariness, and rebellion against God's chastisement, God's going to take me out of the world and not let me live any longer." He said, "Sunday night, I'll be in the grave." That was on Friday afternoon. That night, that man died with a heart attack. And on that Sunday night, his body was in the graveyard. He died. He committed the sin unto death. He realized it. It's revealed to him. He committed the sin unto death. And he died and was buried. And he was only about 45, 50 years old at that time. And he could have been on the earth serving God and served God for maybe many years. And there's Christian people in heaven today, saved people that died because they committed the sin unto death. They could be down here adding souls to their account, doing things for God, laying up treasures in heaven, supporting God's work, helping people. But no, it went their way. And God says, "I bring them on in." And God took them in. They died a premature death. They committed the sin unto death. Stand up. Father, I pray in Jesus' name that you'll take the message and use it because it's the word of God. I pray, our Father, you speak to all of our hearts today and help every one of us to check up and not commit the sin unto death ere we go to an early grave. Lord, bless thy people. May this message be heard and rightly taken in that it might be profitable. Have your way, dear Lord. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Debbie, I want you to play for us. Is anybody here today and God tells you to come to this altar, you obey God. Sinner, saint, whatnot, God tells you to come down here for any reason, you obey God. I want you to play a stanza, so how about it? Young man comes, his hands wet with perspiration. God got a hold of me. He said, "I want to be saved." Breathe up a prayer as we wait for others. Anybody else, would you come? Come on, if God is speaking to your heart. Thank you. Anybody else for any reason?